everybody. Sorry about the delay with starting the concert. There's a bit of technical difficulty, but this video should be perfectly fine to broadcast, so thank you. Welcome to the last concert of the Glissando season. I'm so honored to be able to be playing a wonderful program for you today. We're going to be starting with the Beethoven Sonata No. 30. This is one of his last sonatas. It was written in 1820. It's unusual because it differs from the typical sonata form. Although the first and the second movement technically do follow sonata form, they have a couple of characteristics that make it so that the listener doesn't really perceive it as such. The first movement has huge contrast between two types of material. The first type is a flowing, more lyrical, vivace material, and the second type of material is really tense and anguished, and it's full of diminished seventh chords that help add a lot of dissonance and sort of a more edgier and feel to it. And so there's these two types of sections keep on alternating throughout the first movement. The second movement explodes right from the get-go, and it moves directly from the end of the first movement into the second. And so the second movement is furious. It is very unusual because typically in sonata form, the second movement tends to be slower or it tends to be softer, but this is, it is fast and it's loud and it's just really just enraged. And then the third movement is a theme and variations, which is very atypical for a sonata to have. The theme is stated a bit more lyrically and simply at first, but it goes through a number of different transformations before reaching a climax in the sixth and last variation. And at the very end, the theme is restated, much like it was in the beginning, but with slightly more, slightly deeper and slightly richer harmonies supporting it, which evoke a holy and sacred feel to it, much like one of a chorale. Beethoven was particularly interested in counterpoint in his later years, and so you'll hear a lot of that in the, especially the fourth and fifth variations of the third movement. So I hope you enjoy, and without further ado, Beethoven Sonata No. 30. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
still broadcasting. Hello, can everyone still hear me? Sorry, technology is very much not on our side today, but I just saw the notification that my video got blocked, apparently because Naxos thought that I was playing some of their music. But if you guys can still hear me and everything's still broadcasting fine, please comment below. If not, I'll try to figure it out. Okay, great. So it seems that it's broadcasting still fine now. So our next piece is Chemin Papillon, and it was written in 1831. It is inspired by one of Schumann's favorite authors, Jean Paul, one of his novels. And so in this novel, it really centers on two brothers, two twins. And so we have Walt and Volt, and they both fall in love with the same woman. And at the end of this novel, there's a masquerade ball in which all three of these characters are there, and Walt and Volt, the twin brothers, they decide to switch costumes during the masquerade ball. And this woman declares her love for the man that she thinks is Walt, but is really Volt in disguise. And so Volt, upon realizing that there's this mutual love between them, he decides to leave, and saying to Walt that he no longer needs this brotherly love and brotherly friendship because he has a new romantic love that he has found. And so because the end is a masquerade ball, many of the movements are waltzes, and so they have a dance feel to them to evoke the feeling of the ball. The last movement starts with the grandfather dance, which traditionally is used to signal the end of a big celebration, in this case the ball. And at the very end of this last movement, we can hear the clock striking in the distance before everyone leaves for the end of the ball. So I hope you enjoy Chemin Papillon. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
concert. I'll be playing Ravel's Gaspar de la Nuit. This was written in 1908, and it's based on a collection of poems by the same name, Gaspar de la Nuit, by a French romantic French romantic poet, Aloysius Breton. And this collection of poems is introduced by attributing the book, the collection of poems, to a mysterious man. And so this character is in this park, and when the man wants to return this book of poems to this man, he can't find him, and he realizes that he was actually the devil in disguise. And so each poem is prefaced by a short excerpt from other authors. And so the first poem that Ravel chose was Undine, which depicts a water nymph who tries to seduce a mortal man. The second poem depicts a man hanging in the gallows, and in the background we hear a bell tolling from inside city walls. And the third poem is Scarborough, and so that depicts a sort of mischievous imp or goblin who flits in and out of the darkness before disappearing into the night. And so now I'm going to be reading the three poems, first in French and then in their English translations. Undine. Je croyais entendre une vague harmonie enchanter mon sommeil, et près de moi se pendre une rumeur pareille, au chant entrecoupé d'une voix triste et tendre. Écoute, écoute, c'est moi, c'est Undine qui frotte de ses gouttes d'eau les losanges en dehors de ta fenêtre, illuminée par le monde rayon de la lune. Et voici, en robe de noir, la dame châtelaine qui contemple à son balcon la belle nuit étoilée et le beau lac endormi. Chaque flot est un ondin qui nage dans le courant. Chaque courant est un sentier qui serpente vers mon palais. Et mon palais est bâti fluide, au fond du lac, dans le triangle du feu, de la terre et de l'air. Écoute, écoute, mon père bat l'eau croissante dans branches de talons vertes, et mes sœurs caressent le bras d'écume, les fraîches îles d'herbe, des nénuphars et des galets, où se moquent du sol caduc et barbeau qui pêche à la ligne. Sa chanson murmurait, elle me supplia de recevoir son anneau à mon doigt pour être l'époux d'une ondine, et de visiter avec elle son palais pour être le roi des lacs. Et quand je lui répondais que jamais une mortelle, boudeuse et débitée, elle pleura quelques larmes, poussa un éclat de rire, et s'avenuit un gibelet qui ruisselèrent de blanches le long de mes vitraux bleus. I thought I heard a faint harmony that enchants my sleep, and close to me radiates an identical murmur of songs interrupted by a sad and tender voice. Listen, listen. It is Undine who brushes drops of water on the resonant panes of your windows, lit by the gloomy rays of the moon. And here, in gown of watered silk, the mistress of the chateau gazes from her balcony on the beautiful starry night and the beautiful sleeping lake. Each wave is a water sprite who swims in the stream. Each stream is a footpath that winds towards my palace, and my palace is a fluid structure at the bottom of the lake in a triangle of fire, of earth, and of air. Listen, listen. My father whips the croaking water with a branch of green alder tree, and my sisters caress with their arms of foam the cool islands of herbs, of water lilies, and of corn flowers, or laugh at the decrepit and bearded willow who fishes at the line. Her song murmured. She beseeched me to accept her ring on my finger, to be the husband of an Undine, and to visit her in her palace, be king of the lakes. And as I was replying to her that I loved a mortal, sullen and spiteful, she wept some tears, uttered a burst of laughter, and vanished in a shower that streamed white down the length of my blue stained glass windows. Le gibet. Que vois-je remuer autour de ce gibet? Ce que j'entends, serait-ce l'abysse nocturne qui glapit, ou le pendu qui pousse un soupir sur la bouche fatibulaire? Serait-ce quelque prion qui chante tapis dans la mousse, et la lyre stérile dont papetier se chausse le bois? Serait-ce quelque mouche en chasse sonnant du cœur autour de ses oreilles sourdes, à la fanfare des alalis? s'arrête quelques escabeaux qui courent en son vol inégal, un cheveu sanglant à son crâne chauve. Ou bien s'arrête quelques araignées qui broient une demi-onde de mousseline pour cravate à ses cols étranglés. C'est la cloche qui tente au mur d'une vie sur l'horizon, et la carcasse d'un pendule que rougit le soleil couchant. What do I see stirring around that gibbet? Ah, that which I hear. Was it the north wind that screeches in the night, or the hanged one who utters a sigh on the fork of the gibbet? Was it some cricket who seems lurking in the moss and the sterile ivy, which out of pity covers the floor of the forest? Was it some fly in chase sounding the horn around those ears deaf to the fanfare of the halos? Was it some scarab beetle who gathers in his uneven flight a bloody hair from his foul skull? Or then, was it some spider who embroiders a half measure of muslin for a tie on the strangled neck? It is the bell that tolls from the walls of a city, under the horizon, and the corpse of the hanged one that is reddened by the setting sun. Scarbo. Il regarda sous le lit, dans les cheminées, dans le bahut. Personne. Il ne put comprendre par où il s'était introduit, par où il s'était évadé. Oh, que de fois je l'ai entendu et vu, Scarbo, lorsqu'à minuit la lune brille dans le ciel comme un écu d'argent sur une baignée d'azur semée d'habits d'or. Que de fois j'ai entendu bourdonner son rire dans l'ombre de mon alcôve et grincer son ongle sur la soie des cortines de mon lit. Que de fois je l'ai vu descendre du plancher, pirater sur un pied et rouler par la chambre comme le fuseau tombé de la conuit d'une sorcière. Le croyais-je alors évanoui? Le nain grandissait entre la lune et moi comme le clocher d'une cathédrale gothique, un créneau d'or en prune à son bonnet pointu. Mais bientôt son corps bluissait, diaphane comme la cire d'une bougie, son visage blêmissait comme la cire d'une lumière. Et soudain, il s'éteint. He looked under the bed, in the chimney, in the cupboard. Nobody. He could not understand how he got in or how he escaped. Oh, how often have I heard and seen him, Scarbo, when at midnight the moon glitters in the sky like a silver shield on an azure banner strewn with golden bees. How often have I heard his laughter buzz in the shadow of my alcove and his fingernail grate on the silk of the curtains of my bed. How often have I seen him alight on the floor, pirouette on a foot, and roll through the room like a spindle fallen from the wand of a sorceress. Do I think him vanished then? The dwarf grows between the moon and me, like the belfry of a Gothic cathedral. A golden bell shakes on his pointed cap, but soon his body becomes blue, translucent like the wax of a candle. His face pales like the wax of a candle end, and suddenly he is extinguished. And so now, Lavelle's Gaspard de la Mie. Enjoy.
Thank you. Thank you.
so much for tuning in, and I hope all of you have a great day.